Okay. Why don't you get a little closer? You're gonna be talking.
Bringing it in.
Yeah.
Bringing it in.
How to use the fundamentals within moves. How to make more complex moves. And then dancing the full movement. Oh, this is something I noticed for you. Dancing the full movement even when it's fast. And then just talking about the quality of movement.
Okay,
awesome. But yeah, I noticed a lot, like being totally immersed in the dance. One thing you notice, or at least I notice, if you're dancing many nights in a row, you need to start dancing a little bit more efficiently. Otherwise, your body's going to fall apart and die.
Okay.
You know, just like stuff like bending your legs more. Normally it's like, I'm not going to bend my legs because I'm being lazy, but it actually takes more energy to not bend them. Overall, because you're not as efficient in your movement type of a thing. Because when you're lazy here, you have to make up for it somewhere else. And you want to use all of your body. Yeah.
So at Lindsay Fest, we had Dumbos. And someone did take that class. What? Too bad it wasn't a follow-up.
Yeah,
it was my husband, but I watched it. I hung out with Andy Reid a little bit.
Seems like a pretty cool guy.
Good.
I think he did really good in the Jack and Jill. How did he place that?
He did not win.
Oh, I see.
But that's too bad because he's so funny. I did watch it though, at the end, when they wrapped it up. And so we got to see some of the Dumbos. I posted a video to the site
with
Dumbos and Harry Thompson, I think, from the movie. And they're talking about Duel.
Facebook group?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes. Oh, and to all the Cornell people, Andy Reid, big shout out to you guys. He didn't think that you would know who he was. So, I thought about this as I was, like, fluttering my hair for the very last dance. I should have gone around and gotten shout outs from all the Ithaca dancers.
Yeah, you should have the GoPro on your head.
No, I'm not that ridiculous. Just like even.
That would be cool. Like you'd be at a perfect height for capturing someone's face.
So I did have an opportunity to talk to. I posted a bunch of articles from Bobby White on the site.
Yeah.
On this group. I talked to Bobby White. I talked to him about the heavy follow.
Yeah.
Boom!
Shazam!
Shazam. So.
How did that combo go?
I talked to him about your statement about the, he talked about the top of air, which is the heavy follow. And then he highlighted the baby bear, which is the correct one.
I like it already. Yeah.
Yeah. But he didn't really talk about mama bear, which is the other way when it gets too light. And there were some statements in there that were kind of nuanced, which is like, okay, he talks about when the follower automatically.
medium bear? Is that?
Mama bear is the light bear.
I thought the baby bear was the
light. No, because remember he goes to daddy bear, and it's so hard, and then he goes to mama bear, so soft, and then he goes to baby bear, and it's just right.
Oh, yeah, I forgot the story. Okay, yeah, okay, got it.
Or Goldilocks.
Goldilocks, right.
Yeah. So Goldilocks is the follow.
Okay,
yeah.
All right, there we go.
Yeah,
metaphor
okay.
Online.
We got it. Got it.
So
we talked about that. Another one was when the follow, sits back too much, you know? And again, sitting back too much, we have to sit back some, right?
Yeah.
Again, they're like, oh, we have a brand new answer, and you say sit back too much, and it's like, well, where is too much? I don't really understand too much.
Right.
So if you don't say what the mama bear thing is, what happens when I don't sit back at all?
Then, yeah, also not giving me much joy.
Or even just, no connection,
Yeah, it's hard for us to do that.
The dead fish, you know?
Yeah, then it's not really a partner dance anymore.
So we kind of had that conversation, and I think he was really shocked, because apparently people don't give feedback.
People don't have questions of that sort type of a thing?
No, I think that when you get to a certain status in Lindy Hop, that it's a lot of you're the best, you're so amazing.
Oh, as opposed to actual questions?
As opposed to actual questions.
Oh, I see.
Sorry.
But yeah, I noticed there was a lot of follows to dance with, and some were heavier than others. Quotation marks, still don't like that. But I noticed there's an adaptation factor that happens. Like some are like, I am going to be magnitude 8 no matter what. But I think that the really good ones adapt to you and you adapt to them, and then you can kind of build it. And then you can kind of build it up, I think. A lot of times I'm gonna be super sensitive, so then it'll start out really light, but then they'll stay light the whole time.
Right.
But you want to start out sensitive, figure out where that person is at, and then kind of figure out how much you can kind of crank that up.
So, and then his thing was, I feel connection across the country is pretty good. And I'm like, well, do you dance with the beginner intermediates everywhere you go?
Yeah, that's a very good point.
It's hard because, again, as a well-known instructor, your time is so stretched, I think. The people that have the nerve to ask you, the people that have been dancing long enough to be able to do that. So it's not, I think Sky was one of the few people that, even at this event, that it was because you can kind of look around the room and ask the people to dance.
Yeah, I saw him dancing with non-pros.
Non-pros. So, I would be more curious if you look more, but most of them kind of, not that they only danced with themselves, but when they did branch out, it was still towards that
upper echelon type of thing. Yeah.
Yeah, so when he said, let me put it this way. When I go to another scene or another whatever, people don't know who I am. So beginners ask me to dance.
Yeah.
So,
I think it's also the level of connection and how fast you can have it. You ask someone to dance. And even before you touch hands, when you touch hands immediately, you can kind of tell, this is going to be a good dance. You can tell because, the adaptations on a micro level are right there. Because the follow's you can tell that they can tell where your weight are, where your weight is. Oh, you figured out so fast.
Well, I don't know about you as a lead, but me as a follow, I spent about the first third to half of the dance dancing very, very, very careful, very basic.
Yeah.
I don't do anything fun. I don't even really sit heavy. I'm a very good girl. Because I want to make sure I don't miss anything. I want to make sure I have a very good understanding of the lead. And
I think that's the bridge building part.
Yeah, and I want to make sure I have a very fine-tuned understanding of, what hiccups. Because sometimes the lead seems really good and you start doing something, and then they just go off the reservation, and you're like,
dialogue.
Exactly. So, you know, if I dance them a second dance, then I might just go for it. But I'm not really like focused on the music, I'm not really focused on anything. I'm really just listening the whole time, or for the first half of the song. And then as soon as I'm like, he's not going to go crazy on me, then I start like sitting back and having fun. And I feel like, you know, I dance in the back corner, you know, and I feel like the dancers up there, when they dance with me, they don't know me from whatever, just the time by the way.
Yeah,
so they're kind of going the same way with me. They're like, she could be beginner soon. So they're giving me like real easy stuff. And then as soon as I feel like I'm ready, you know, we're just sitting here doing like, they do really easy beginner moves with me. And then as soon as I feel like they are not going off the reservation with me, you know, then I'll be like, okay, I'm ready for this, you know, and I sit into it. And then that's when we start having fun with our moves, you know,
right.
Having fun with the music. But really, the first half of the song will be pretty conservative.
I tested that because it's like, I'm going to try, it's like, I could tell that we didn't have enough connection, not us in particular, but at Lindy Fest to do a certain move, and I tried it and it didn't work out. I was like, wow, I could have predicted that. I knew that it wouldn't work yet, but it would work with this follow if we had the progression. And the reality is, I did that move like maybe 10 seconds into the dance, and it was just kind of like a trick variation.
But I feel like I have two different sensitivities in my hand.
Yeah.
I have like a local sensitivity.
Yeah.
And then a national sensitivity.
Local and a national?
Locally, I don't think I'm very useful. Like,
oh, right.
I know I can just jump in and back. You know? But when I'm dancing nationally, I'm pretty sensitive.
Yeah. Okay.
Because you don't know what you're going to get. When you're dancing in your scene, you kind of have an idea of everyone's going to the same class, everyone's going to the same stuff. You know, everyone took that same Charleston class from so-and-so. Everyone took that same class from Jordan.
Right, they've been dancing with each other.
Right. You start, like, the immediately from the first beat, just going for it, you know? But when you dance with someone nationally, like at a national event, you don't know what Charleston move.
Right. There's so
or what
options.
Footwork move they're going to try to lead you into.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, and I think that just reading a person, like, where their weight is at, because it's not overly obvious how a person takes spins and how much twist or torso or how low center they are or where you even find yourself on their back, if it makes sense. You know, like, tiny stuff like that, you kind of got to feel it out. You don't get that right out of the box. That's why you start with the
ice. So there's a bunch of Cornell dancers that are going to the Mines. That's the
Charlie. Boston Tea Party.
So hopefully this will be helpful to them.
Yeah. How to go about an event.
I hope all of them have been to one, but
psychology to the table so you're not plagued by fear or distress or anxiety.
So, like, not this.
Yeah, so you're not like, oh gosh, I'm scared. People are looking at me.
Yeah. Or the space.
Oh, right.
Smile for these people and then yeah. What are you doing to me? And I definitely saw that in some of the intermediate
classes. Right. Yeah, you gotta enjoy yourself a little bit.
Did you see it?
I looked at it a little bit. That's always kind of.
There was one guy, and he was just like pretzeling this poor girl. She went with it. He was just pretzeling her, pretzeling her. I was like, is he ever going to get her to swing out? And afterwards, I talked to her, and she was just so upset. She was like, I didn't even have a chance to do anything that I could. You know, there was never a chance for me to work with it. And I don't even think he really wanted Lenny off. I think he really wanted Val. And that's why he kept wanting to do all these, like, circular moves and arm moves and stuff.
Going to Val or something.
Yeah, he kept wanting to learn Val. So he kept trying to do other stuff.
Oh yeah, there's all sorts of horror stories that can happen. She got off easy, but that can totally happen.
That girl?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, you find out like how scared these people are, but yeah. And then timing. I know that one person told me that if you're offbeat at any point, forget it.
Oh yeah, that's painful to watch, especially to judge, I'm sure, even worse so.
So,
also like knowing the structure of the music, so you know when the breaks hit, so you can put in a cool move.
Yeah.
Also is very pleasing.
That was the other thing, musicality. And, you know, you have to do a swing out at some point, otherwise it's just jazz moves.
That's right, yeah. Swing outs, please.
It is. Just
produce a good swing out, they want to see that.
And, lastly, this is like the last thing someone said to me, is difficulty. If it's like a tiebreaker between two people, then they look at difficulty. So while you're thinking like difficulty is so important, they actually look at that as like, if it's a tiebreaker.
A tiebreaker, yeah. Because sometimes people will play way too risky trying to do very
difficult
things.
But really,
they'll sacrifice their technique or timing.
Yeah, like you need to play to your level.
Have a solid base.
Yeah. And then only really take it a little bit up to make sure that in case there's a tiebreaker. But don't play so high to your above your level.
Right. Don't leave beyond your ability type of thing.
Yeah. So one thing that someone did with me that I thought was really good, and if you're competing, this is a great thing to do for that whole come together thing, is moving around the floor.
Oh, right. Yeah, like before they officially start? Or do you mean like during the competition?
Even during the competition, like during your spotlight?
Yeah.
Okay, what is something when you just go like straight back?
Slide or like a jump?
Or just even like right before you're gonna do a...
Before swing out type of thing?
Yeah, so I had a talk with all this stuff or whatever, and you and your partner just want to be kind of like meshing
together.
Yeah, like that's a really good way to be like, okay, now we're gonna.
You can have like stuff like that.
Well, even not messing with it so much, but just gelling together. I mean, like, okay, I've got you. You know, we're together.
Yeah, do together movements for a partner. Yeah.
Exactly, for partner points, for that, like, we're the same moment, we're in the same thing. Now, you know, what else can we do to be together?
Yeah, that's a good,
it's
very
a
good
really, like, connection thing to kind of, especially if you're working with a partner that's maybe not, if you're Jeff and Jill, you realize that you and your partner aren't on the same level.
Right, yeah.
Like,
but,
come together.
Even before it starts, like when you're walking around to pick your spot, you definitely kind of have like a little bit of like pulsing or walking around. So you're not actually just walking because you're building up connection when you're doing it. So
exactly.
It's just a little secret bonus.
And you know, that was the point that they were saying about Sylvia. She said from the second that you walk onto the second you walk off, and that she's watching the whole time.
Ooh.
I shouldn't have used names, but.
Yes.
Ooh.
Anonymous judge, the masked judge.
But I think she documents her project.
I know I would if I was looking. I'm like, wow, they can't
do that. I was going to use any names this time.
The names may
or
may
not
have been changed.
No, but she's one of those judges. But she's, if you watch her, she never loses it. Like some judges will be talking and getting into her, and she's in it to win it. So.
Right, yeah. So. Even more reason to try and connect with your partner early is that the judges might be looking at that, so definitely do that. You can wow them before the song even starts.
For the record, I never spoke to Sylvia. How about that?
Okay.
So this is all you're saying.
Okay. Yeah, I'm down for it.
Okay.
I'm down.
Okay, what else?
Did you have any other tips? You had technique, you had timing, you had teamwork.
Okay, that was it for, so yeah, but most of the judges, or the people that I talked to that were judging competitions, said that the three T's of judging, they were pretty consistent T's.
Yeah.
So, I was asking them, like, can you go above and beyond the three T's?
I say creativity is a dangerous game. It's a good one, but make sure that it fits within the three T's type of a thing.
Yeah, and when I say beyond, the three T's are your foundation.
Bread and butter.
So you still have to have those. So I have to say that once I knew my three T's, and then I started talking to people, it really made watching competitions a whole different game because, you know, you start thinking that, like, what's important is, like, musicality is the most important thing or whatever, and, like, oh, they're the best ones because they, like, hit these breaks, and, like, why didn't they win? They were, like, but actually, they might have not had good teamwork, they might have not had good technique, or, they might have been off beat, you know?
Yeah, it's like the three T's you mentioned are kind of universal. Judges will look for that. But judges might have different other dance values that they like more so. Some might weight more teamwork, others might like technique, others might like originality or something like that. So there's all sorts of variances. But if you focus on that core stuff, then they're all going to be looking for that.
So, oh, I just got a message that,
someone's a little nervous
from this group about the weekend. I hope this helps.
About this coming weekend?
Yeah. Okay, we hope this helps.
That's right, yeah.
Okay, so with that said, one of the heavy hitters that's an instructor this weekend.
Will there be lessons taught at the Boston Tea Party? What type of weekends?
I would have to Google that, but I'm pretty sure that
there's competitions.
And I'm assuming approximately years that there is some sort of instruction. I think it's one of those ones that's been around forever, and if they've been around forever, they usually do competitions with some sort of instruction. So I'm going to.
Yeah, we'll
I'm just going to lean towards yes.
Okay. Even if they don't, like, you can learn a lot just from social dancing alone. And competing, you learn a lot about yourself pretty fast, actually. When you're under the gun and the spotlight's on you, it's different when it's just you and your partner. When people have pen and paper and they're watching, you know, it's a little different. It brings out different sides as well. Like, I never want to take dancing too seriously, but that's definitely a time to work on your technique, because you want your technique to look really, to look good. You want to look pleasing.
So, one thing about competing is you want to have quality in your movement.
All right.
Quality of movement?
Yeah.
So, let's get to quality of movement. Because I did watch a jazz class. I watched it.
Almost as good as.
Almost as good. Do you know why I didn't take it? Because I would have had poor quality of movement.
Right. So, quality of movement. Typically, I would say, the more of your body you can implement in any given movement, the better. Because it's going to be poor quality of movement if you have just an arm. And if your arm's connected to a body that's moving, it's a little bit higher quality information, higher quality movement. Where would you like to go with this?
Let's do our basic.
Okay.
And let's... Basics. Because we're warming up. Let's just do a really casual, easy.
Okay.
Really any connection.
Okay.
So that
it's not
we should push out this 3 miles. to correct Mikey. Mikey, do you know how heavy Mikey can be?
I don't know. Is he heavy? Absolutely. And I did notice, like, for me, I did have, light on balls that weren't light type of a thing. I'm like, how would I actually have to adjust this person?
First of all, you need to take the lights off.
I know. What is the, like someone who has a higher magnitude than my base was, and I was noticing what would happen when I did not adjust to that. And by that I mean groundedness type of a thing. Because I started out not as grounded.
You take them grounded with you.
Yeah, that's true. You can do that, yes.
You take them grounded with you. And then if they don't go grounded with you, you know, if they're just not there yet in their understanding,
yeah.
Then just keep it, keep it easy, but that doesn't mean you dance less.
Well, what I mean is they start out more grounded than I am. That's what I mean. That's the situation that I was playing with.
But that's the whole, you kind of just feel it out first, right?
I am trying to feel it out, yes, but I'm noticing like what happens when I don't. Like if I don't feel it out, and I notice them being very grounded, which isn't inherently wrong or anything, right? And I'm not being grounded.
That was another thing about you, right? You can be too grounded. Like too in the ground.
Right.
That doesn't mean grounded is wrong.
Alright, I would say that grounded is actually a really nice virtue to have.
Grounded is like it's necessary.
Yeah, it's really fun. Turns out it's pretty good for connection and all sorts of things.
It's it's necessary like for what we do for the dance.
Mm-hmm.
It's necessary for Charleston. It's necessary for swing outs. It's necessary for our jazz movements. If you're trying to do all this stuff on top, what actually happens mostly if you're not grounded is you end up doing most of your movements not on your toes. That's really what happens. Most people that aren't grounded are on their the rest of their foot. And then when they try to move, they're like on their foot and they think they're grounded and they're really not. They're on the but once you're really grounded, you're on your toe. And that's where you need to be. Because that's how you get your movement.
Right. But you've probably experienced this a lot because your default is more grounded than most. You probably have a lot of really light weights that can't handle that groundedness.
Yes.
And you know how that shakes their balance, their footwork, because they don't have the groundedness.
Oh, yeah. I totally danced with this guy that's like, woo!
Yeah. So, like, if you're...
I feel like the interview, that big one, and then the guy just dances around her. I feel like that, but it has nothing to do with that.
Right, yeah, besides.
It's just they haven't. And it's like, they don't even give me the, they're so light that they just give me a little bit of connection, like be grounded. Woo!
Yeah. So it's like.
They just get in right away.
Right. It's just, I like the situation where the lead is just a fraction more grounded than the fall. I'm not sure if you have a preference on that.
Yeah, I like that.
But I think that the lead should be just a fraction more grounded.
Yes.
Yeah. Because with a lot of these follows, like in some of these cases, like I didn't like it when I was a fraction less grounded than they were. You know what I mean? Like that made things slightly out of my control in terms of like momentum,
yes.
Direction.
Exactly.
Right. So that's what I'm trying to talk about here is that for those follows that are slightly more than me,
you have to take it up.
That's right, and I need to do that.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it would be nicer if the middle ground could be reached. But I should be adaptable enough to go.
And especially this.
Yeah. That's what I was noticing, because I noticed for some of them, maybe they weren't the most seasoned, and they had one format and one way of dancing, and just happened to be, a little bit more grounded than mine. It's like, could I match that? The answer is yes, and I should have.
And that's why I felt like this first, beginning, whatever the dance, when I was dancing, felt kind of like.
Yeah.
No, because none of us were really, we were kind of sure, what the other could do. And then it was just kind of,
fluctuated within the dance. So it felt like I was pigeonholed into being a certain amount of grounded type of a thing. When I like to use the contrast to kind of show when the leads are happening type of a thing. So it was like all intensity 8, like magnitude 8 earthquakes all day. Which is good, but I want maybe just a little bit of contrast type of a thing. That's like the sugar fish, like you're not hardcore the entire time. You got a moment of like a moment of release type of a thing. So I feel like sometimes I don't want it to be an arms race, for example, where I ultimately have to match whatever bet my follow is and then raise them. I think that's just an adaptability issue, where it's like I should have adapted faster.
You know what though? I think getting back to the competitions, you know, I'm talking about a whole song that I would do this, but I think that you want that warm up, and that's kind of what you're doing in your warm up, right?
Right.
At that little beginning part of the song.
Yeah.
And then you're like, okay, let's see where we are. Where my shoulders are, and my feet are going to be under my shoulders.
movement.
What are your feet doing? You're doing this.
Yeah.
I don't know what they're doing.
You don't.
Real hard Sunday night, and I thought I'm really gonna wait for this, and I woke up Monday.
But in your own mind, you can be the best dancer you want to be. It's okay to be inspired.
You gave me a hug afterwards.
It's okay. Bless your heart.
They told me to learn French.
That's right.
I mean, that's gotta be like...
Fun doesn't tell every girl to learn French.
I'm sure it was learn French so that I can tell you how much you suck.
See how bad you really want his instruction. Yeah. That's right. I don't have the vocabulary to complain.
Actually,
chicken waffles.
They were. Kind
of complex moves. And this one doesn't truly come from a sugar fish. I would say that it probably comes more likely from Lady Hawk offer of hand. Then you have one, maybe two spins. And then, you know, that's a 12 count move, so who knows where you are in terms of with your timing with the song.
Go with the music.
Yeah.
If you're competing, you should know enough about music.
Right. But that's the point about this correction, is that when you spin them around, that's why I'm setting this up, is so that when you can have this absorb move, it'll continue going and you can just kind of like chill out here. And you can wait for things to reset. You can wait to swing out when you want, and if you're two counts ahead or behind, you can hang out there and really stretch, and then release that when you want.
And you should really practice sitting together.
Yeah, exactly. It's a huge stretch moment. Sit. Sugar fish? Okay. I'm gonna do sugar, and then I'm gonna do into the move. Here we go. Pop. And then I'll have two spins.
Sorry.
No worries. So let's say we're just off time. We're going for a. So it's just very slow, kind of like this.
Yeah, if, like, Annika, if you want to, like...
Yeah, just keep on moving into it.
The point is to not stop.
Right.
If you just stop and sit...
Right, that would not look as good. Is that the song is even, if the song can have a hold or a stretch in it as well.
Yeah.
So you can be like, ooh, and then you can have your send out.
You can even, if
yeah, it should be on the outside.
But, I mean, you could even,
Right. There's other things you can do with it.
Yeah.
But it's a good way to, like, it's a normal move, but just stretching it changes the timing.
Also, on a double turn like that?
Yeah.
So, if you're giving me a double turn, and I have really good shoes that spin, I can spin, like, right here forever, right? But for some reason, let's say that my shoes just don't spin, and I can't do the dictionary definition of a spin, and I have to walk it out.
Yeah.
Like actually walk through it. Just leave my shoe
behind
me.
Right. So to follow like your center and try to make it make sense.
That was one thing. I didn't at Lenny Fest like some parts of the floor like they were as spinny as others. And I was in my kids. And I've like hit one of these like sticky spots and people were like, doing these spins, and I'm like,
So that would mean that you would want the building blocks behind stuff, meaning that you would want control over triple steps, steps, and kick steps. You want to be able to control all those things and kind of make what you want, right?
So Dimitri, he's been dancing a while. So probably long enough to know, like, we got spins, we got this, we got, like, we've got this, okay? We can do this.
Right.
We can do these kinds of things all day long.
Yeah.
We can do this. When I was there, we went over like 8 different kinds of spins. So he knows spins. And he knows like all different kinds of like slides and stuff. So he's got vocabulary. Can you just teach him how to build it?
A lot of that is just tinkering, I think. It's just figuring out moments that you can. You can change the timing, if you can stretch something, if you can have a level change. Sometimes if you add a level change into something, it's making it a completely different move. Like when you do your sugar push variation where you go down with the low.
Jean did it.
Yeah.
She did this. She did that.
Right, so it's still a sugar push.
She did this.
But now it's a little bit more than that, you know.
She did that. So I was wrong. This is a Jean. She didn't throw it together. She just says, so it was a gene move.
Nice. Yeah, that's cool. Very cool.
Yeah.
Also, you could do things like by trying different basics in different stances, just being very creative with that. And one thing I did, and this maybe not, this is just an example, but it's like I was side by side and I had like normal Charleston. But then I started to lead like 20s Charleston side by side. Which, you know, could yield creative results. That's one way to create moves, is if you use moves that you normally think would be restricted to one stance, and using them in another. Like a Texas Tommy, for example. So you normally have your Texas Tommy, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You know, but you could even do that in a Charleston swing out if you were brave. Yeah, that's a reeking the leg. It's okay.
I
know, it's good. It's good. But yeah, so what else would you say would be a good way to cultivate moves?
Stack them on top of each other. Back to back without basics between them.
That's right, yeah. You could do 2 in a row.
Combos.
Oh, right, yeah. Just figure out which moves bleed together well. Right, yeah, get a combo of play go. It's a good combo. Well,
it's just an example of a good combo.
I always like a good combo where I have a move that I like. It's a Lindy Hop move where we have this, and it's a shoulder twist release, and then I'll follow the column, and then I can go up like that. So that's a good combo because it's a very rotational move that ends with a very rotational ending. So that's a fun way to do that.
On a side note, know your rules.
Know your rules.
Yeah. Know if you can have your feet leave the ground or not. Those are your rules.
Yeah.
I got knocked out of the competition and it pays me for that.
You're saying that when you're competing, know if you can do aerials or not? Is that what you mean?
Or even because he did something and I went like.
Okay, I
but
see.
Both feet left the ground.
Right, okay.
It
I
wasn't
guess
an aerial.
Read the fine print, I suppose.
It wasn't an aerial.
There's probably no harming of your fellow competitors, no sabotage.
Was that an aerial?
No aerials, perhaps.
But it was like.
Yeah,
both feet came off the ground.
Sometimes you could easily
But there was just so much energy that I just went, I was like,
yeah, I guess be careful with that.
Yeah, you get DQ for some dumb things sometimes.
Some of them, obviously, if you're a frog jump, obviously you have screwed up.
It was right after, like, stuff like that. People just got fed up with stuff like that at LHC. It was after LHC that ULA just came on and you were like, no, fucking no. We can't take it anymore.
So they're doing it strictly, right?
They're doing it strictly. And that's
okay,
usually,
that's cool.
That's usually, you have to come to that ground.
I see. Yeah, you could totally come up with your favorite moves and totally sculpt sequences. I know that that's not favorite, but if you have like a common move thing, you can totally do that. Yeah, it's not the most true Lee Follow thing, but I think with Strictly stuff, you can kind of plant stuff. You know what I mean? Like when you have like invitational Strictlys or whatnot.
Yeah, I mean, you can have like,
I do have some.
They have like breakaway footwork stuff that they have.
Yeah. So I think that some sequences can be fine. I mean, the whole thing is not going to be core.
Like, they did that one that was like, remember?
Peter and Naomi?
Naomi and Scott.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I remember Peter and Naomi. They've had some cute partner stuff in the past. Yeah. Just find what you're really good at and what you really enjoy and just kind of try and exploit that and see what you can do with it. You know, like, do you like level changes? Do you like stretches? You know, what are your favorite moves?
Be careful of this.
Yeah, make sure that you have a swing out that can go quickly. strictly they might, they'll probably play three songs, right? To judge slower, medium, and a fast.
I just noticed on one of the videos that they sent me that when it gets fast, they start to lose some of their stretch.
Right, that's right, yeah. There's less time for the stretch, but the stretch can still happen in proportion to the time spent. But it's all too easy to cut the stretch out completely when it's fast. People tend to freeze up because it's so fast and there's so
Come on, latch on to that rhythm.
sure. Yeah.
Which is kind of the name of our class.
Right. That's one of the main things we're exploring here is how can I get more ground for my dollar here.
Well, the swing outs.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
We're working up to that, and hopefully physically getting strong enough to do that.
Yeah. I noticed that even within kind of like my minor moves, like you have to maintain your quality of motion, your groundedness when you do stuff like that. Can't get distracted by spins or.
So even in like spins and stuff. Okay, so that's what we were going to talk about, some of the fundamentals, like within a move. So we do these like really great swing outs, right?
Swinging it out.
Right? And everything looks really good. And then we start doing moves, and then we don't feel like, and then again, I split my weight.
Yeah, it's not as concrete or sharp-shifted and delicious as you.
Right. That's.
And leaders, we're the worst at this, and you know what I'm talking about, because many times it's like, I'm leading a tuck turn. You're following me doing nothing, but many times, like the lead will just totally slack off on his stance and his steps during a spin. Or, like, when the follow is spinning, like, we're not doing anything, type of a thing.
Right.
But you need to be. I always imagine that even though you're not touching your follow, they still can feel what you're doing.
No kidding.
Right? Yeah, it's just like this magical effect. Like, even if we have a moment like this where we're not touching, in my head, I imagine that she still can feel what I'm doing.
Which is why I just stopped.
Right.
You stopped.
Yeah, exactly. And it's also upon the return. Like, let's say we have boom, 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 and whatever it is that we do connect again, like, as we're connecting, if I have a solid, like, triple or step or momentum, you can feel that immediately.
Right.
And you'll even visually see it before. You'll see me going this way. Like, every sense needs to point towards good dance. Like, I come on, come on, come on. I'm like, oh, whatever, some. For sure. But.
Well, mostly because I felt momentum stuck in your hand.
Yeah. Yeah, I was trying to jade, okay.
Right.
I was trying. Yeah, no worries.
Oh, my eyes. Sylvia and Sky the other night, like they still had a nice rhythm. I'm not gonna because clearly there's confusion with that word. But the rhythm that they had going was there. But they had that smooth style, and their momentum was just nice and consistent and just going. And I loved that.
Very flowy type of a thing.
It was never ballroom. It was still Lindy Hop. It was never King Collins. You know, I never had that like width. But it was smooth. And I was like, I really like the California style. That was so nice.
Yeah.
We're.
Yeah, momentum's pretty cool.
Momentum's still important.
Yeah. I think the momentum is a little bit deeper than I realized, or at least there's ways to explain it that have not been explained to me, or I have explained to other people as well. Like, how do you set it?
I was trying to get like more of a conversation with Sylvia about that, but she just looks at me like, like, I'm serious, she just looked at me like,
can we just
yeah, that's, like, it's cool. Like, she just looked at me like, I don't know what you're trying to say.
Some of these things are hard to explain.
Yeah, it's hard to say it like.
You need to have some sort of an answer to that, to try and figure out how to pursue it yourself so you can experience it, you know?
So I was just like, I need to think about the question I want to ask before I ask it. And I just like, I can't just.
Hey.
That's going to be two spins. But in some cases, that's not the case. Like, you have to very much adapt to your follow.
Just watching, like, Nikki, I was like, I told her, like, when I grow up, I want to be like you. And I don't even know if she's older. I'm going to be older than Nikki.
Yeah.
I was like, when I grow up, I'm going to dance with her. But she was just like,
that's right, yeah, because it's like, for our double spin, if I've given, like, you know, maybe each interval, like, this insane the amount of momentum that I gave you, she would go, like, eight times type of a thing. But that's just because people are calibrated differently. It's something you have to, once again, there's no one-size-fits-all type of thing that I'm looking for. I usually want a one-size-fits-all.
And I know, like, years ago, I used to just put this thing on my arm, that anytime someone gave me a spin, like,
oh, right, I see.
And
the auto assist.
Yeah, and I was doing myself.
Because, right, yeah, some followers, they do have that element and stuff where they're like, you know, and they're like,
I know, because I used to do that. And then I was like, you know, you're missing a lot, though, when you corner, but when I asked Remy to dance, he was like,
no pressure.
Like, no one else was waiting.
I was gonna check out the Nouveau dancing scene. What way is that?